Hello, I'm Rick Crosland, or should I say, Science Claus. Today I'm following a tradition started in 1825 by Michael Faraday of the Royal Institute of London, England, to provide a Christmas lecture program for the public, and especially for children. Now this year I'll be joined by some amazing Wayne Township teachers, Keith Ramsey from Bridgeport Elementary, Mary Mason from Chapwood Elementary, Allison Kimpers from Wayne Preschool, and Justin Abner from Maplewood Elementary to present the 12 Days of Science Claus. While this is our fourth annual Science Claus is Coming to Town program, this year we embrace the science of our times, social distance, mask wearing, and hand washing required.
On the first day of Science Claus, my teacher gave to me a candle of light energy. On the second day of Science Claus, my teacher gave to me two spinning knives and a candle of light energy. On the third day of Science Claus, my teacher gave to me three beakers boiling, two spinning knives, and a candle of light energy. On the fourth day of Science Claus, my teacher gave to me four flying planes, three beakers boiling, two spinning knives, and a candle of light energy. On the fifth day of Science Claus, my teacher gave to me five flaming hands, four flying planes, three beakers boiling, two spinning knives, and a candle of light energy. On the sixth day of Science Claus, my teacher gave to me six safety goggles, five flaming hands, four flying planes, three beakers boiling, two spinning knives, and a candle of light energy. On the seventh day of Science Claus, my teacher gave to me seven gases burning, six safety goggles, five flaming hands, four flying planes, three beakers boiling, two spinning knives, and a candle of light energy. On the eighth day of Science Claus, my teacher gave to me eight magnets pulling, seven gases burning, six safety goggles, five flaming hands, four flying planes, three beakers boiling, two spinning knives, and a candle of light energy. On the ninth day of Science Claus, my teacher gave to me nine frozen flowers, eight magnets pulling, seven gases burning, six safety goggles, five flaming hands, four flying planes, three beakers boiling, two spinning knives, and a candle of light energy. On the 10th day of Science Claus, my teacher gave to me 10 waves vibrating, nine frozen flowers, eight magnets pulling, seven gases burning, six safety goggles, five flaming hands, four flying planes, three beakers boiling, two spinning knives, and a candle of light energy. On the 11th day of Science Claus, my teacher gave to me 11 sparks discharging, 10 waves vibrating, 9 frozen flowers, 8 magnets pulling, 7 gases burning, 6 safety goggles, 5 flaming hands, four flying planes, three beakers boiling, two spinning knives, and a candle of light energy. On the 12th day of Science Claus, my teacher gave to me 12 smoke rings floating, 11 sparks discharging, 10 waves vibrating, 9 frozen flowers, 8 magnets pulling, 7 gases burning, 6 safety goggles, 5 flaming hands, four flying planes, three beakers boiling, two spinning knives, and a candle of light energy.
A new video will be presented each of the 12 days prior to our holiday break. We hope to dazzle your senses and intrigue your mind with some amazing science demonstrations. On behalf of the Wayne Township Education Foundation, we want to thank our title sponsor, the Indianapolis Airport Authority, as well as our supporting sponsors, Epic Insurance Midwest and the Indiana chapter of the American Chemical Society. Only with their help are we able to mix the holidays and science in the Wayne way. Welcome to day one, light energy, when my teacher gave to me a candle of light energy. Michael Faraday, his first public lecture was on the combustion of the candle. Because a candle is pretty amazing. If you think about it, a candle starts as a solid, turns into a liquid, and into a gas. But in today's 12 days of science class, we hope to show you a few more things, like this candle right here. It's in a candlestick, it's cylindrical, but is it really a candle? Join us as we explore light.
Michael Faraday invented the dynamo. He discovered when you spin copper wire inside a magnetic field, it creates an electromagnetic energy.
Thomas Edison was the pioneer of searching for that perfect filament for light bulbs. He wanted to take that electrical energy and change it into light energy. He tried everything from bamboo to human hair until he finally found it with that carbonized cotton. But I wonder, did he ever try a pickle? So we have this pickle as our filament. The electrical energy is going to travel through the wire into the pickle, and we're gonna see if it can act as its own filament. And right now, the sodium ions are starting to get excited. You can see some action happening. And then, finally, we have light. And those sodium ions are showing off that yellow color coming out right there. Wow, what a great way to have a pickle lamp.
So when we talk about light, that's one form of energy. There are many forms: mechanical, chemical, sound, thermal, electromagnetic. Let's show you how I take my chemical energy from the food I ate to now kinetic energy as I strike these two balls. No light, but I hear sound. I wonder what'll happen if I strike this aluminum and see if we can make it combust, maybe get some light and maybe some sound. Wow. That was cool.
What I've got here is a mixture of potassium chlorate and sugar. I'm gonna add one drop of sulfuric acid. It's gonna decompose it into chloric acid and potassium sulfate and create what I like to call white fire. Check it out.
We've learned a lot about light energy in this short video. Wouldn't Thomas Edison love to have a light bulb like this that just comes on its own? What the problem he had that we still have today is light bulbs have a vacuum inside, and when they get hot, when I turn this on, you can see that it gives off heat and it gives off light. About 40% of the energy is wasted as heat. And the trouble is, we have to find something special to light up. So what I've done here is this light bulb, I've taken the gas off, I've taken the vacuum off, and when I turn it on, it's only gonna last a second because that tungsten exposed to air will catch fire. And this light bulb will be done. Ready? Watch carefully. So you see, it lasted less than a second and burned completely out. But what if we could find a way to keep the oxygen away from it? I don't know, Thomas Edison probably didn't have liquid nitrogen, but this time I'm going to put this inside of liquid nitrogen And then I'm going to ignite it, turn it on. We'll see what happens. Ready? Here we go. Immerse it. And on. That is so cool. No oxygen is getting to the filament, so we have light. Of course, it'd be hard to keep liquid nitrogen light bulbs in your house. And what do you think is going to happen when I pull it out? The oxygen is going to cause the tungsten to ignite. Ready? Here we go. I hope you enjoyed our first day of 12 Days of Science Claus. See you tomorrow. Welcome to the 12 Days of Science Claus, Day 2, Two Spinning Knives. In this video, we're going to talk about motion and how things move and how they change their position with forces. There's been some great scientists who've studied this, from Aristotle to Galileo to Isaac Newton and even Einstein. You can learn a lot more by studying those scientists. So this is a cool thing I have right here. It's a gyroscopic spinning top. And once it's spinning, it resists falling over because it has something called angular momentum. In fact, if I try to push it over, it won't even spin it over. I can even set it down. So I got this guy spinning. Let's see what happens if I can get it a string like right here and bring the string up and put it on the string. And it will keep spinning on the string because of its angular momentum resisting falling over, even though gravity's pulling on it. Of course, eventually it will fall over when it stops its spinning. Let's see what happens here. Still spinning, and it'll start to process on around. So things that spin have stability. So things that spin are supposed to be easy to keep in the air. I don't know how good I am at this. Let's see if I get it going and get it going and get it going. Not too bad, not too bad. Oh, I know someone that's better at this than I am. Mary.
So once we have it on its axis, this momentum is gonna keep it right where it needs to be. And we can go up, we can go down, and it's gonna stay on. But if we go sideways, it's gonna fall off. But maybe if we can get it going, maybe we can even get it to go straight up in the air and come back on it. We're gonna go up in the air and it still goes.
Okay, so we can learn a lot about how things spin. So here is a pretty cool wheel you'll find in a lot of science classes, and forces act upon it. If I let go, it comes down because of gravity. But if I can add some spin to it, now we're getting something called angular momentum, which is pretty cool. This should stay in this position, but then torque around and it stays upright. When things move, just like Isaac Newton studied and Galileo studied, there are forces of nature at work that you can learn. In fact, let's go outside and see some forces of nature of spinning. So, when you spin around like this, there are forces of nature acting upon you. And these have been studied by a lot of people. So let me see if I can stop here. And what's gonna happen if I add some more mass and I hold these out? I should go slow, because now I have large rotational inertia. And my velocity, or my spin, is kind of slow. But watch what happens when I change this. Ready? Did you see me spin up? And I can slow down by moving these weights. Now, this is a force you need to know. What will happen if I add more weights, more mass? Here's some 20 pounders. Let's see, here we go, right? There we go. Wow, this is a lot. I better start with them out. And I'm going pretty slow velocity until I bring them in. Whoa! Better slow it down or bring them in. And you probably have seen this on television. Ice skaters make good use of this. But I better stop before You see some more forces of nature. Let's take a look at Allison, our preschool teacher.
Science is everywhere, guys. Are you ready to see how gravity brings you down? Let's do some twirling. We gotta do two spinning knives.
Plasma, day three. My teacher gave to me three beakers boiling.
So we've got three beakers boiling here because inside the beaker is liquid nitrogen. This is a cryogen that boils at negative 320 degrees Fahrenheit. And if I pour some on the table, it'll boil at room temperature and evaporate right off the table. Check it out. It's gone! The minute it touches that table at room temperature, it boils and evaporates right into nitrogen gas. Check it out. I'm going to tell you about plasma. Plasma is the fourth state of matter. We grew up learning about liquid, solid, and gas, but plasma is the greatest form of matter in the universe, and it occurs when you have ionized gas. This was Nikola Tesla's dream to have wireless transmission of electricity. This is a miniature Tesla coil. You have a primary coil and a secondary coil. This is the breakout point where you'll see plasma. I'm gonna get it close to my neon ampule. Check out what happens. What's happening right now is the plasma is traveling to the neon gas inside the ampule, and those electrons are getting so excited that they're traveling to an outer energy limit, and they're releasing photons of light that vibrate at about 500 nanometers per second. And through the light spectrum, that appears to us as the color red. Another demonstration that I love to show is how plasma can demonstrate the difference between a conductor and an insulator. A pencil has, look, lead inside, and lead will conduct plasma, but the wood is an insulator. So I'm going to use my plasma, and I'm going to touch the graphite in the pencil, and you can see the plasma is transmitting all the way to the ampule. But the wood is an insulator. If I touch the wood of the pencil, if I get close to it, notice my ampule doesn't turn on. But if I go to the graphite inside the pencil, which is a conductor, look what happens. My ampule wirelessly turns on.
The last demonstration is the whoosh bottle. It's a weak plasma, but it's a strong demonstration. Watch what happens when you hear and see the whoosh bottle. Let's turn the lights out. And here we go. whoosh. And the byproduct of combustion? Water. Day 4. 4 airplanes flying. This is all about pressure and air pressure. Pressure is pretty interesting. Pressure has to do with force over area. But you can't have an airplane unless you have air. So let's talk about air just for a second. Air is a gas that's all around us. And we have the press of air, or air pressure. Now, Indianapolis is 751 feet above sea level. But scientists like to measure air pressure in pounds per square inch. And so at sea level. So this is what's called an atmosphere bar. This is 14.6 pounds. And this represents how much air is from the sea up to outer space, about 50 miles plus or minus. And all that air, which is made of matter, takes up space and has mass, is pressing on us all the time. Some days, if you're a teacher, Fridays has a lot more air pressure. So this pressure, we don't feel it because it's pushing on all parts of us. Now, scientists have studied this, and one of my favorite, which you need to learn more about, is Daniel Bernoulli. He was one of the Bernoullis, 122 genius, a whole family of geniuses, and he worked out what we call today the Bernoulli principle. If we can get a gas or air to constrict, get smaller, two things happen. Number one, its velocity goes up and its pressure goes down. So there's a couple things we can do with this. For example, here is, I like to call this a Bernoulli bag. It's a long bag. Wonder how many breaths it'll take me to fill it up. Let's see. There's one, and not much. But if I use Bernoulli and his principle, we hang this right here in our tree, and now I'm going to step back and I will inflate this, or attempt to inflate this, using the Bernoulli principle. So I'm going to hold back and I'm going to shoot air, constrict it, make it go velocity, and use the sky to fill it in and see if this works. Ready? Not bad with a little blow and with a little bit of science of Bernoulli. Now, he also did things like this. If we can, you know, you can understand if I get this air going right here, straight up, the ball will go straight up. That makes sense. But if I get enough velocity of air, the pressure, I should be able to lower this all the way down. Let's see what happens. Ready? Here we go. And now see if I can tilt it. That's pretty cool. Of course, gravity always takes over. Another fun thing to do, well, if you have any of this extra laying around the house, is if we increase the airflow over this, much like an airplane wing, we can cause lower pressure, and this should go up. Let's see what happens. Ready? Pretty cool, Bernoulli principle. You know, all that air stacked above us has pressure, air pressure, like this mat right here. If I drop it down, now it's got all the air, 14 pounds per square inch. And if I lift up, I can almost lift the table up with it. That's a lot of pressure. And we need that pressure if an airplane is gonna fly. An airplane like this FPG-9, it goes, flies in the air.
As many of you know, if you've taken part in the summer safari, we are lucky enough to go tour the Indianapolis airport. In there, we get to see the big planes fly. But the other thing that's kind of fun is to try the FPG-9. And so, 4 planes are flying.
Since this is a day all about pressure and being under pressure, pressure has to do with force, divided by the unit of area. So if I had a nail like right here in this cantaloupe, dropping this cantaloupe on this nail makes it a very bad day for the cantaloupe. So that's because all that force was in a real small area. But what if I drop a cantaloupe on a bed of nails? Oh, better yet, what if I lay on a bed of nails and drop a weight and break a brick? Let's try it. As you can see, I'm laying on a bed of nails, and I'm hoping that all that force is going to be spread across all these nails. Let me lift this mass up. I think that might be high enough, 35 pounds. Protect my face. And let's see what happens. Pressure, force over area. 3, 2, 1. I survived the impact. Am I filled with holes? Let's find out. Ah, no holes. I think I'll stick to 4 airplanes flying. Day 5, my teacher gave to me 5 flaming hands. So an exothermic reaction has to do with heat being produced. This one is called knock your socks off, and I borrowed one of Santa's socks. Let's see how this works here. I have a chemical called calcium carbide, which is in a solid form, and if I add some water to it, the reaction changes it into a gas, a flammable gas called acetylene. So let me put the water in, let's see what happens. Ready? And wait a minute. I hear some gas being made, but let's see if we can knock Santa's socks off. Exothermic. 3, 2, 1. Hey. Wait till Mr. Ramsey shows you some really heated decomposition.
So in this cool exothermic reaction, what I've got inside the test tube is potassium chlorate. And through thermal decomposition, it's going to turn into potassium chloride and chloric acid. And then I'm going to sacrifice a gummy bear. And when I lower that gummy bear, the glucose molecule is going to oxidize, and that little gummy bear is going to combust. Check it out in this incredible decomposition reaction. Here's my gummy bear in 3, 2, 1. He's screaming, but you can't hear him because his little lips are gummed shut. Oh, the poor gummy bear. Here he goes. He's still combusting. Check it out. Very exothermic in this cool gummy bear sacrifice.
No live bears were hurt in the making of this science demonstration.
In this next exothermic reaction, I'm going to take a little bit of calcium carbide, I'm going to add it to this beaker, and then I'm going to pour ice cubes on it, and right away you're going to see a decomposition reaction where acetylene gas is released. We know acetylene gas is highly combustible. We want to find out what will win out, fire or ice? And as I add the ice cubes, you can start seeing a little bit of acetylene gas. I'm going to prime it with just a little bit of water. Right away, you can see that gas is starting to form, and I've got all my ice cubes ready. Let's find out what wins over, fire or ice. Check it out. The ice cubes look like they're on fire. I feel the side of the beaker, and it's still cold because of the ice cubes. But if I feel the bottom of the beaker where the reaction is taking place, it's really hot because this is an exothermic reaction. Fire and ice. Check it out. I love this exothermic reaction with methane. All you need is to mix a little bit of methane in bubbles. We know that when methane decomposes with oxygen, it just releases water and carbon dioxide. Check out these bubbles in my hand. Look at that.
And my hand is okay because all the heat convects upward away from my skin.
Five flaming hands!
Day 6, pendulums. My teacher gave to me 6 pairs of goggles. Pendulums. They're really kind of simple, but they have played an important part in the development of motion and particularly clocks and time. A pendulum has basically 3 parts: a bob, a cord, and a pivot point. Now what you see right here is something we call harmonic oscillation, which is a fancy word of saying it repeats the pattern over and over again, and it's swinging back and forth. Galileo, early on in the 1600s, the story goes, noticed that a chandelier was swinging in his church, and he started studying motion. Before him, Aristotle had studied it, and after him, Newton and even Einstein have studied motion. But what he learned from the pendulum was pretty amazing. See, we told time was by the day and the night, that cycle. But clocks could not do anything very accurate. There was no accurate clock. But here's what Galileo discovered, that when you displace a pendulum, by displacement means how far off the center. So if I just put it like this, that's its period. And if I even displace it more, like way up here, the period is the same. Even if I double the mass, the period's the same. What he discovered is the way to change the rate of a pendulum has to do with the length of the cord. So if I have a short cord, we have a quick period. If I have a long cord, now he and some of his colleagues decided, I wonder what is the correct length for 1 second. So they set up a famous experiment. During the night, they looked at a star, and as the earth rotated, they started swinging a pendulum, giving it special little pushes to keep it going all through the night, all through the next day, until that star, the earth rotated, and was right above the point on that roof. And they counted those, and from that, they were able to determine how to make a Galileo clock, a second, and that's how all of our clocks and watches today have to do with harmonic oscillation. But just, you can try this at home. Here is a large pendulum, and I have the period. And if I move it up a little bit farther, like say up here, and if you just watch the red marker, let's see what happens. And that is the beauty of a clock with a pendulum. It was the first way to make accurate time, and then scientists could start quantifying their experiments. Now, if you put a bunch of these, check out this pendulum right here. This pendulum has all at the same level, but different lengths. So they should all rotate back and forth at a different rate. Let's see if I can get this right. Here we go. And you start to see some patterns. Maybe you'll see them. I see them. Here we go. 3, 2, 1. I could watch that all day. Slow, long, quick, short. And you start to see these come in and out of sync. I start to see patterns. You should too. Oh, now we're getting back to threes and twos, and that is amazing. In fact, there's a whole bunch you can do with pendulums. Let me show you this next one right here. This is pretty amazing. There was a clockmaker who was using a clock, and he noticed that he was homesick one day, and his clock was on the mantle, tick-tock, tick-tock, and he noticed that all three of his clocks were moving in the same harmonic oscillation. It's because the energy was going through from clock to clock and they were getting in sync. So here we have 2 cans on a string, and the string allows the vibration to go through. Watch what happens when I let this one go. back and forth, back and forth. But what's going to happen if I let one go and not this one? Let's find out. Ready? You could do this at home or in your classroom. Now it's going back and forth, and it's going back and forth. The energy is harmonic oscillations are traveling through, and now it's slowing down, and this one's going back and forth. I wonder if it's going to send that harmonic energy back through again. Let's see what happens. Yep, this one's starting to go. This one's starting to slow down. They're both moving. That's pretty cool. Motion is all around us. If you use your eyes and your ears, there's a lot you can observe. I got one more, but this one takes just a little bit bigger setup. If a small pendulum works, a large pendulum ought to work. So I hooked this 12-pound bowling ball up to a pivot. It's my bob, and it's got a lot of potential energy. We know potential energy turns into kinetic if I let it go. Hope it doesn't hurt this this Christmas ornament. Let's see what happens. 3, 2, 1. Oh, that's fine, that's fine, that's fine. And, okay, that could be a problem for this next thing. Here you go. All right. In a closed system, I'd be in big trouble. Potential energy, 3. Wait a minute, but I know about friction. Friction is the interaction between two objects. In this case, between this ball and the air. And I'm counting on friction slowing this ball down and not ruining this handsome face. Here we go. I hate this part. 3, 2, 1. Now a brave man would run right now, but okay, I believe in science. Oh, and you notice each time, because of friction between the air, it is slowing down. And a little bit of friction up there in the pivot point. If only we could turn this room into a vacuum, the thing would go all the way. Well, I don't know. Hey, pendulums. Day 7, gases. My teacher gave to me 7 gases burning. And I happen to have here some thermite.
In this demonstration, I want to show you how hydrogen gas is extremely combustible. What I have here is a flask with hydrochloric acid, and I have a small wad of aluminum foil that I'm going to add to the flask. At first, nothing happens because the glaze around the aluminum foil has to be corroded. The second step in this reaction is to cover the mouth of the flask with a balloon to catch the gas that's going to be released. So I'm going to stretch this balloon over the mouth of the flask so the neck is right in the middle. And this is a very exothermic reaction as the hydrochloric acid breaks down the aluminum foil and decomposes it into aluminum chloride and, of course, pure hydrogen gas. And that's going to inflate the balloon as soon as it starts to decompose. Now, this is a really important reaction because in 1937, we had the Hindenburg disaster. The Hindenburg disaster was a giant blimp that looks like the Goodyear blimps that are filled with helium, but the Hindenburg was filled with hydrogen gas. And in 1937, an electrostatic spark ignited all of that hydrogen gas, resulting in the death of 36 passengers. And we want to find out if hydrogen gas is still flammable today. And I can feel the exothermic energy coming off the flask. It's very hot, and I can see the balloon is starting to inflate. One essential question in this reaction is, where does the aluminum foil go? Because it's going to vanish. Pretty soon, there'll be no aluminum foil left in the flask, just aluminum chloride, and of course, pure hydrogen gas that we know from the Hindenburg disaster is highly combustible. Still inflating. I can still see bubbles coming off the surface. The last step is to twist off the balloon and to test the combustibility of pure hydrogen gas. And that moment is upon us now. If you look closely, I can't see any more aluminum foil in the flask. So if you turn out the lights, this reaction will be really amazing. You might want to cover your ears. It's going to be kind of noisy as we recreate the Hindenburg disaster from a flask. Okay. In 3, 2, 1. Amazing! Hydrogen gas, so very combustible.
So this is one of my favorite demos. It's called the ooh-ah flame test. And I better hear some oohs and ahs out of you. So I have 5 different elements or 5 different compounds. They're actually some metals. One of them you might know, which is salt. And we also have copper chloride. And we have some lithium chloride. Now each of these, when they burn, should give off a distinct color. The flame test that scientists use. Let's see. 5 different gases. Check it out. Here we have potassium chloride. Here we have copper chloride, green. Here we have lithium chloride. Here we go. Red. And then we have our strontium chloride. And finally, regular salt. 5 different beautiful flames. All coming from one of the properties of matter. Ooh, ah.
Another flammable gas that we'd like to show you is the combination of boric acid and methanol. And whenever you combine an acid with an alcohol, you get an esterification reaction, or an ester. And an ester is used to make perfume or cosmetics. And so I'm going to combust this mixture of boric acid and methanol, and you'll see that we get this beautiful green flame. But look what happens when I rotate the flame in this basket. I get this amazing green fire tornado. One essential question is, what causes the tornado or the fire to rise? Well, if you look, the basket has openings all along the side. And of course, fire needs oxygen in order to burn. And as that oxygen enters the sides of the basket, it combusts in the direction that I turn the basket. And so this fire tornado is turning in the direction that the basket moves as air is combusted in that same direction. Check it out, my green fire tornado.
7 gases burning, but not all gases burn. In fact, a very important gas, helium. Let's see here.
Helium doesn't burn, but it does something kind of cool.
Experiments with magnets. Day 8, magnetism. 8 magnets attracting or repelling?
I love magnets. Magnets attract, opposites attract, or they repel. They also attract iron. 8 magnets attracting. This is magnetite, and it's, let's see if it attracts to it. It does, it attracts. All these magnets, this is awesome. I think, I may need to go get some moisturizing for her face mask. I need a little moisture.
I have no idea where Allison went. Moisturizing and magnets, how do those go together? But I do know that a magnet has an invisible lines of force, but you can see them if we add iron. Because magnets attract other magnets and iron. So here's a magnet. I'm going to put it down, and I have some iron filings here, and I'm going to spread these on the top, and you might get to see those invisible lines of force. Wow, look at that. And you can see they're stronger at the tips or at the poles. If I vibrate this, there are the invisible lines made visible of the magnetic force. And if I turn this over, there should be a magnet holding that. Cool. But there's more. I've set this up right here. Here you see I've got a magnet in here, and I've got 3 little magnets, and I've got them set so they repel each other. And this is so cool as they keep trying to repel away from each other. Electromagnetic force, repelling. What would happen if I turn this magnet over? Now they are opposites. And they attract. That's so cool. The Earth is a giant magnet, and because of magnets, we can make compasses. And compasses are kind of cool because they help you navigate in the dark or when you can't see the land. One of my favorite projects that I've done with a lot of students is the floating ping pong ball. So what you see here is a ping pong ball that's floating. Well, actually, I have a nail sticking through there, but there's a gap. See that gap right there? There must be some invisible lines of force. Let's try some things here. What's gonna happen? Make a prediction. I put plastic between here. Plastic. Whoa, it's still there. Maybe thick plastic. Still there. Piece of glass. It's going through the glass. Here I have a piece of wood. Not attracted by wood, not affected. Here's some aluminum, thick aluminum. It's a metal. How is this happening? You know, here's a piece of brass. Even some copper, another metal. In fact, these metals don't seem to be doing anything. The last metal I have is a piece of lead. Protects Superman from kryptonite. It's malleable and very dense. What? You see, there's invisible lines of force. Maybe I can cut them with my scissors and see what happens. Ready? Let's see if I can cut these. Here we go. Ready? This is the hard part. And what? Did I ruin that magnet? I don't know. Let's see. Maybe you can figure it out. Well, one more thing I want to show you. Magnets are attracted to iron. And in those scissors, there was iron. There's no iron in any of this material right here, so it wouldn't be affected. So this is kind of just weird. I mean, this is just weird. Here's a piece of copper. This copper is so weird, and I have a really strong magnet. Now, when I drop this, if you watch, one, two, three, it falls. It follows the rules of motion. But what's going to happen when I put it in this hollow copper tube? It shouldn't be attracted to it, but ready? Watch. 3, 2, 1, drop. And it fell in slow motion. 1, 2, 3. Wait till you see this from the top. That's amazing. Those are called eddy currents. When you have a strong magnet, it induces a special current and slows it down. I wonder where Allison is.
Oh, hey, I just couldn't stop thinking about magnets, so much so that I have here a mud magnetic mask. Wow, guys, science is awesome and glamorous. Let me demonstrate. Watch this, this is a magnet, and I'm gonna pull out the iron. How about up high? Magnets are awesome and glamorous.
So liquid nitrogen, you can do some amazing things with it. And usually the students hate this. They would rather take this home to their mom. But this is science. So I'm gonna see what happens when we freeze a rose in liquid nitrogen. First, you might see it start to boil. And as it boils, any liquid in it is gonna be frozen and it'll stop boiling and the properties are completely changed. Looks pretty cold to me. The boiling's almost stopped. I wonder if it still has the same properties. One way to find out, here we go. Looks the same until I do this. That's pretty cool. If it works with one, how about 9? So I got 9 of them. We'll put all them in here, all 9 of them. And what you see right here is 9 frozen flowers. Day 9, cryogenics, things that are cold. And one of the coldest things I know is liquid nitrogen. Now, liquid nitrogen, nitrogen is everywhere. In fact, it's 70% of our atmosphere. But there was a couple scientists that found a way to liquefy it. And this is liquid nitrogen, and it is very, very cold. Minus 320 degrees below zero. But more importantly, it expands. It expands 694 times the ratio of its volume. So it's so cold that if I put my hand in it, that would do a lot of damage. But there's a thing called the Lindenfrost effect. So when I pour this actually onto the table, this table is so much hotter than this liquid nitrogen that it will boil and make a vapor barrier, and you won't even see it get the table too cold. Or even on the floor, if I try it right down here on the floor. Here we go. That's pretty cool. But if you really want to see it, let's pour some in a column here. And you notice that hot goes up, cold goes down. And all these vapors, this is water vapor from my breath, that's going down. That's not nitrogen, because nitrogen is odorless, colorless, and basically inert. You can't catch it on fire, you can't do any of that. But if I add a little bit of water to it, that will definitely cause it to start to change its properties. That's kind of cool. Not the nitrogen, but the water. And there's a lot of cool things you can do with it. Let's see some more. So, I have here a piece of rubber tubing, and matter has different properties under different temperatures. So when I drop this down in this liquid nitrogen, first thing it's going to do, you start to see some of it come out the top there. But I am now super freezing this rubber, and I wonder if it's going to have the same properties it had at room temperature. I kind of doubt it. This part up here, still bendable. This part down here, not so bendable. In fact, it's lost all of its properties of rubber, just like that, and it bounced in there.
I want to do a fun experiment with you where I'm putting liquid nitrogen inside this Pringles can that is empty because Mr. Crofton ate them all. So as we know, liquid nitrogen right now is boiling because it's above negative 320 degrees and it's turning into a gas. So as we know, gas takes up space, it expands as it heats up, builds up more kinetic energy. Seal this up and pressurize it, and it pops the lid off. Pretty cool.
Justin did a really good job with the Pringles, so I'm gonna try a metal can. That might take a little more force. Let's see what happens. Liquid nitrogen expands 694 times its volume, and hey, that was a good one. Maybe one more. Ready?
We've been talking about expanding gases, so now I want to dip a balloon that's been blown up into liquid nitrogen, and we can see that the air isn't going to expand. This is actually going to contract because the cold nitrogen is slowing the air molecules down into the balloon, and it's losing kinetic energy. And we can see it's shrinking and shrinking. And eventually, if you kept holding this down, it would get crinkled up because it's also rubber, the balloon, and it gets hard and crispy. And you can hear it. And what's really cool is when we take it out, it's out of the cold. It's warmer air. So it's speeding up the air molecules, and they're bouncing off each other now. And as they're bouncing off, it's expanding slowly. And eventually it's gonna expand right back to the original volume and shape that it was from the beginning. Pretty cool stuff.
Another way we can use cryogens is to cool superconductors. And I brought with me my superconductor trap and a couple of discs here that are made of yttrium, copper, barium oxide, ceramic. And when you get these discs really cold, amazing things happen. Before I start, I want you to notice that these discs are non-ferromagnetic. They're not attracted to each other. They're not attracted to the track. Notice that they don't repel each other either. But when we cool them down to negative 320 degrees Fahrenheit, the crystal lattice of an yttrium barium copper oxide starts to open up what are called flux tubules, little openings in the crystalline lattice that are imperfect that allow for magnetic vortices to swirl through them and to hold them in place. Check out what happens when I now take a cooled superconductor and put it over a magnet. It starts to levitate, and I can even push it along the track. Now I'm pushing it with a plastic tong because I don't want the metal tong to stick to the magnetic track, but also because I don't want to touch it with my hand because that'll warm it up. And when it warms up, it loses its superconductivity. This track was made by Dr. Boris Almog of the University of Tel Aviv. He's studying the Meissner effect, quantum locking, and flux spinning. So when I told you about those microtubules that allow for little magnetic vortices to pass through them, that's his research that is affecting how well these float over the track. Here's a larger one. Notice when it passes over the other superconductor, it's not attracted to it. It just simply floats right over it. Quantum levitation brought to you by Science Claws.
Here's another cool science experiment with liquid nitrogen, where if you pour it slowly enough on top of warm water, and I colored this water so you could visually see it since it's clear, you can see the liquid nitrogen floating across the top because it's less dense than water. Now, you might be wondering, why is it moving? Well, with my hand tilting the cup and it hitting the water, obviously I'm transferring some of my energy and gravity's pulling it. But you can even see, if you look close, ice from the water. That liquid nitrogen is freezing some of that water and creating an insulator where it's separating the cold from the heat. It looks really cool. It almost looks like ghost on water. So we've been dealing with liquid nitrogen, a really cold product. So now I'm gonna do a cool experiment with dry ice. Now dry ice is extremely cold. It's carbon dioxide frozen into a solid at negative 110 degrees. Now, when we put it into water, it speeds up that process. Now, something interesting about dry ice is, so dry ice, as it changes states of matter, it goes from a solid straight to a gas. It skips the liquid phase, which is called sublimation. So as you're seeing right now, this is in water. Inside this container here, I have a tube, and I'm gonna build up the pressure a little bit, and as you're gonna see, it's gonna start coming out the ends. But what's really cool, when you can put this into soap mixture, you can make these awesome carbon dioxide filled bubbles. As you dip it in, you actually can even sometimes hold some of them depending on the gloves that you have. And as you can see, they're bouncing. Look at that as I poke it. Oh, it's bouncing around. It's awesome. Hot air balloons go up, cold air balloons go down.
sound energy. 10 waves vibrating. So this is a model of how sound waves travel. Go ahead, you start the wave and let's see what happens on here. You can see it's traveling along because it has something to travel through called a medium. We can also make a low sound, and that just looks where it just has a little bit coming through. Or we can make a high sound, and that's where you have a lot of waves coming through very quickly. I wonder what happens if I start the wave and it goes to you. Can we start at the same time and see if they can meet in the middle? Let's see who wins this war. How about you try one, then I'll go. Wow, sound is an awesome thing.
Now, I do a lot in our schools with sound energy, and you know that I believe that sound is energy. And if you can make something vibrate, you can make a sound. So we have some experiments here. This first one is, even if I got a ruler to vibrate, listen. Or if I made it smaller, or longer, if you get it to vibrate, it can make music. In fact, this is a tuning fork that we use. Let's see if I can get it to vibrate. Kind of hard for you to hear that. But if I amplify it with this large glass, so the study of sound is pretty amazing. There's a lot of things, and if you can get air to vibrate, you can have a different sound. What do you notice? These three tubes, these boom whackers, hollow, different length. So that means a different column of air. This sound, together. Maybe you heard both of those sounds. And a lot of you, I've worked with these. These are my palm pipes. Palm pipes because, look, three different sizes, and you use your palm. Here we go. And a short one. Have you started to pick up a pattern there? Long, big things make low sounds. Small, tiny things, I can't do it. High sounds, but if I could, that's what it'd sound like. But you don't have to have just the air, maybe the actual object will vibrate. This is so cool. If I hit it, you can hear like a bell, but I'm not gonna hit it. I'm gonna rub it. It's vibrating and resonating out. If I touch it, it stops. That's pretty amazing. And I'll try this. This is called my, this one is a pretty cool experiment. I've got a hollow tube here, but I have some, it's made out of iron. I have a screen on the bottom of it. If I can heat this air up, I can get this air wave to go up through it. Let's see what happens. Here we go. I gotta remember which end is hot. So I'm heating this up, and you might even be able to see it's red hot. So it's going to cause all that air to go up there. This is called the singing tube. Let's see if I got it hot enough for the air to go up, and you might hear a sound. Almost sounds like a rocket engine. When rockets take off, engineers have to control the sound, otherwise it'll bounce off the launch pad and destroy the rocket. Here we go. If I turn it sideways, no good vibrations. Pretty cool. Now that is something, we can get it to vibrate, you can have fun. And another project, I learned this in San Francisco, and it's really hard to make. You need a bowl, and you need a balloon, and you need these very interesting musical devices. I call them chopsticks, okay? And you stretch the balloon over the cup, and you can get it to vibrate. Not much vibration. If I tighten it, I get a different sound. I know vibration. I don't know music, but I do know one of my favorite ones that you kids have done this with me is the straw oboe. Now, what you take a straw, normal straw, a scissors, and you chew it flat like that, right? Follow those directions. Take a straw and chew it flat like that. Once it's flat like that, you cut it into a point, and you have two little oboe-like reeds. You put your mouth over it, and if it works, now the fun thing about that is, what if I stretch this out? Is the sound gonna go up or down? It's longer, bigger, it should be a lower sound. Huh. Oh, I hate this part, but I should do it for science. Okay, now what if I cut this, right? I hate doing this, this handsome face. Should I do it? My crew doesn't think I should. Should I do it?
Yes, do it!
Okay, here we go. Is my face still there? Okay, let's go for the record. Try that at home, not with a mustache. So you have a lot of fun with sound, and one of my favorite one is what I like to call Blue Man Group. I mean, I was inspired by the Blue Man Group of this, and so you notice these are hollow tubes. You can make this at home too. And they are open at one end, and they're different lengths. Like my family tells me, I need to stick to science, not music, but it's cool sounds. So these are vibrations, but if you want to see some vibrations, check this out.
Another way that we can measure sound energy is as sound waves vibrate through a medium. Ernst Chladni was a German physicist born back in the early 1700s, and he found that when sound vibrates through a medium, like sand or rice or salt, it creates amazing symmetrical designs along nodal lines. So I'm going to sprinkle some sand on my Chladni plate. And underneath the Chladni plate is a big speaker that's linked through Bluetooth to my cell phone's tone generator app. And I'm gonna turn my tone generator to 150 hertz, and I'm gonna turn up the amplitude, and we're gonna see what patterns develop along the Chladni plate, along those nodal lines. Check it out. So you can see at 150 hertz, you've got a clear circle in the middle, and you've got kind of this amazing star shape that goes around it. But when I change the frequency, the design changes too. Ernst Chladni found for every resonating frequency, there's a completely different symmetrical image that appears along nodal lines. Absolutely amazing. So I'm just spreading out my sand so you don't think that I'm making the design. And I'm gonna turn up my frequency now to 250 hertz, check out what happens. Look at this design. Now I've got a circle over here, 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 and here, and in the middle I have another symmetrical image. That's 250 hertz. Now I'm gonna change my sand and I'm gonna increase the frequency to 350 hertz. Check out what Ernst Chladni discovered so many years ago. Here's 350 hertz. Watch what happens. Now look at this amazing design along the edges. Every single frequency has a different symmetrical image that appears along nodal lines. Chladni patterns brought to you by Science Claws.
You can visualize sound and you can hear sound, but I like the way that Heinrich Rubin did it in 1905, a German physicist who invented this device. So, here is the Rubin tube, and I have the propane coming, and you see where the gas comes in, a little bit higher. But what happens if I speak through here, so you can see my sound wave, ready? Hello, hello, ba 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 boo. That's not near as good as a sound generator. Keith, you have a sound generator?
Yeah.
Let's try a sound. Whoa. That is so cool. And a low sound? And a high sound, high frequency? Almost hard to get through. Let's try a little bit higher. How about a low sound? Oh, I love that. Look at that. You can see the same waves that we saw in the spring. Amazing. But you know what? Let's try some music. How about some music, buddy? I could sing, but that won't work. Heinrich Rubin, the Rubin tune. Day 11, 11 sparks discharging. And that's all about static electricity. So static electricity, all objects have charges. And you need to know a little bit about this because you've probably been outside on a day where you heard thunder or saw lightning. That is static electricity. And so I can take this balloon and rub it on my head. Now I got lots on charging it up with some negative waves. And it should be attracted to me. Let me see if you can see it better with this piece of fur and a pink balloon. So I'm gonna charge it up, and now there's a lot of negative charges and they wanna repel each other. Here we go, check this out, look at this. And you see them moving? That's so cool. Nature likes to get things back in balance. Whenever there's a buildup of charge, nature likes to equal things out. And that's where you get a discharge or a strike of lightning. But I'll tell you, you can also try this with a tube like this. And if you charge it up, I am rubbing and I can almost hear little bitty lightning strikes. And it does the same thing with being attracted to this. But if I had something that didn't weigh very much, like let's try this tube right here and this piece of Mylar. Oh, it's stuck to it. Get it off and it sticks to it. And it sticks to it. So in your dryer, you might use a dryer sheet, which is a piece of cloth that has oil in it. And when it gets warm, it puts that oil up into the dryer to pull out those little charges so your clothes don't stick together. But you know, I have this, this wand, a flying wand, and it's rubbing a little motor inside and I'm getting it attracted. And now I should be able to charge it up. And now, they are trying to repel each other. Don't say the M word. This is not the M word. It's science. Static electricity. Pretty cool stuff.
We want to share with you Robert Van de Graaff's high frequency generator. And this is called a Van de Graaff generator. And the way it works is you've got a plastic belt. We know plastic is an insulator that goes inside this toroid between two brushes. And as that plastic belt goes around and around, it pulls the electrons off their nuclei until they start to gather on the toroid. And they also ionize the air around the toroid until there's discharge. And we can see that discharge in the form of plasma between the toroid and this discharge wand. You get close, you can see that spark. Those are the electrons that have gathered on the toroid. They're being pulled off because the wand is a conductor and it's pulling them off. Now we can also see the effect of these electrons on this instrument here. When the instrument's away, the strings are down. When the instrument gets closer, watch what happens. They're pulled toward the toroid until it discharges. When it discharges, then they go down. Isn't that amazing? You can also put this instrument right on the top of the toroid, like this, and you can tape it down to kind of hold it in place. And now you can see again the strings are down, but when enough electrons collect on the toroid, they'll start to discharge and the strings will come up. Check it out. They're rising. Isn't that amazing? Robert Van de Graaff, an American physicist born in Alabama in 1901, Here's his generator. Absolutely amazing. Now let's find out if we have a human put her hand on the toroid, what happens with all those electrons. This is Mrs. Kempers. She is standing on an insulator to keep her from being grounded. Her hand is on the toroid. I'm gonna turn on the generator. Look what happens to her hair. Now, Mrs. Kempers, do you feel any shock at all right now?
Not yet.
That's because she's standing on an insulator. She's not grounded. That's really important for safety. She's standing on a plastic box. We can start to see her. His hairs are starting to, oh, even on her arms are starting to stand on end. Amazing.
Day 12, the grand finale. How about 12 smoke rings floating?
Whoosh bottle.
Don't put your head over.
Bernoulli.
Principal!
Science Claus is headed to the North Pole.
We like to call this demonstration elephant toothpaste, so we've got a toothbrush just in case an elephant walks by. All you need is a little bit of hydrogen peroxide, a little bit of food coloring, some soap, and we're gonna add the soap first. And then we're going to add the food coloring to make it interesting. I'm going to mix it a little bit. And when I add my potassium iodide to hydrogen peroxide, there's going to be a decomposition reaction, and it's going to change into iodine and potassium hydroxide, and of course, pure hydrogen gas that's going to be trapped in those bubbles that we added. So here we go. Check out elephant toothpaste. I got my toothbrush ready. Look at all that toothpaste. Here it goes. Now this steam coming off of it is because it's an exothermic reaction. Look at all that toothpaste. Plenty for an elephant coming by.
My name's Justin Abner. I teach sixth grade at Maplewood Elementary, and I love liquid nitrogen.
My name is Mary Mason, and I teach at Chapelwood Elementary, sixth grade. Sound waves are moving, vibrating, and awesome.
My name is Allison Kempers at the Wayne Township Preschool. Science is everywhere.
My name is Keith Ramsey. I'm at Bridgeport Elementary, and I love chemistry.
Rick Crosland, or Science Claus. Everybody can do science. This is the grand, grand finale, the liquid nitrogen ping pong explosion. All you need is liquid nitrogen and some ping pong balls. Cap the lid, drop it in the water, and put the ping pong balls in. Here we go.
Not there.
No, not there.
And that is a wrap.
That's a wrap.
It's ready.
Oh my gosh.
Thank you, guys.